half covered in mud. You're absolutely covered.
Really?
Watch the
homestation
trick. I can do it if you want.
How is
it?
Okay. Do you want me to hold it?
I think you'll hold the other end. So we need it so that the corners, like how it was before, this.
Yeah, but which?
It doesn't really matter.
These, that end and that end, don't they? I think
yeah.
Is that enough wood?
I don't know. What do you think? I think it's good. I mean, you can just wait for it all to break down.
Bella Joe, Bella Joe, Bella Joe, 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 and my dear, me body.
Yeah, I'm breaking things. This is a half brick?
No, I think I've got better half.
Okay.
Okay, go.
this one.
Yeah. Ready?
Yeah. Is it working?
No.
Oh.
It wasn't on top now.
Oh. If it came to it, I could always unplug it, you know.
Not when you're that side.
No, I could if you moved out the way so that we...
But me holding the drill, that would be the problem.
Yeah, well, that's okay. You hold the drill while I unplug it, and then it stops.
There's a button here that's the emergency stop. Still slightly raining.
Hmm?
It's still raining a bit.
Is it? Oh, I felt it a bit. It would start off seeds in the house and then you would plant them out for the greenhouse.
Even these ones. That was just, this is a, oh, it's a worm.
Is it a worm? Is it a worm? Worms are like.
But normally the greenhouse, this greenhouse is meant to be warm. Not like normal green.
I mean, oh, you mean it's meant to be warmer than a normal greenhouse?
Here.
Yeah, I'd go a little bit back from the wall so that if they're going to really grow in right position, here, then yeah.
Okay. Why are there so many woodlice? Is that thinly enough?
Well, that's just because of what's come out of this bag. I think they've been in the bag. I can take them out as well if you want.
So many.
What is it?
You don't need to be so surprised.
Well, because I thought there was quite a lot of gap.
Well, yeah, a bee got in earlier through one of the holes. I saw it go in. I had to lift up half the thing to let it out.
I think we want to try and make sure that they don't make their home at... They might like it.
Slug. I think there's been home to slugs actually.
I don't really like to put too much on because I hate when I have like cakey makeup on.
It's so good to massage your skin, like really massage it.
I don't just like to put bronzer in my cheekbones, I put it on my actual cheeks too because I think it makes you look more tan. If I had to choose two things to take to a desert island, for sure it would be lip balm and mascara. I would die without lip balm. I love like smudging in my lips. It just makes it look like your lips are fuller without like overdrawing them or anything.
I think the key to highlighter is not being afraid of it. Very important. To contour your face for your face, not the way you see on every YouTube tutorial, because everybody has a different shape.
I usually pluck them, sometimes I wax, but only under.
Sometimes I go do another layer of concealer under my eyes. Toner is really good for balancing out your pH. just want that glow for the gods.
Thank you. He lays out all the ingredients on the counter in front of him, but the meat is still needing to defrost, so he carefully removes each mouse from the vacuum packet and places them one at a time on the draining board. The last mouse to come out of the packet is passed to her with an encouraging look. Dropped into her hand, she begins stroking the little white mouse and lovingly appreciates its tiny ears and toes. She toys with it tenderly in her hand and rolls it over to reveal its cubic side. The mouse had been packed so tightly into the frozen plastic that its muscles and skin had malformed on one side. Saddened by the mouse's imperfection, she begins stroking repeatedly on this distorted part, until its body melts and becomes squishy. Prodding delicately, she attempts to realign the mouse's body, although she hasn't any knowledge of how a dead mouse's body should look if peaceful. After prodding enough to realise that she's probably damaging the mouse's internals, she stops to prevent compromising the tastiest parts. He looks at her with a forgiving smile and passes her a scalpel and cutting board. He prepares a similar set for himself, but with a much greater knife and a long line of mice. Definitively slicing the first mouse's backbone, the first dissection begins. Now separating the organs from skin, with gentle tears the animal begins to be hollowed out. Looking down at her innocent young mouse, she takes a gulp and flips the mouse onto its belly. With one slice, she scrapes the mouse's back, feeling its backbone below the blade. Lifting the blade away, she sees no gash and begins searching through its tufts for any slit leading to the internals. Disturbed but amazed by the mouse's surprising thick skin, she returns the blade to its back, this time gouging with more force. Again, nothing. She keeps scraping the blade upon the backbone until eventually she breaks through. Bending skin away from tissue, the pocket of flesh is opened, and a horrible waft of death fills her nostrils. He picks up the mouse from her, inspects her slow work, and spots a recently broken ankle. Not wanting to slow her further, he pretends not to notice and plops it back before her. Having refreshed from the waft of death, she curiously digs further through the mouse's internals, until eventually the skin has separated enough from the body that only its tender parts remain attached. Instructed to snap the wrists away from the skin, she cracks the delicate wrist bones. Luckily, this mouse's eyes are closed, and so she avoids looking into them as she scrapes its ears and nose from the skull. Impatient now, he takes the mouse from her, snaps its one strong ankle, and drops the insides into a mixing bowl. The floppy mouse skins are discarded into the compost and lie sleeping on a mountain of eggshells. Finger puppets awaiting animation from the earths, bugs, and worms. Red gunk splats in the bowl as rodent pieces are ferociously spun by the mixer. After adding a dusting of this or that, the mixture is licked from a finger and some lumps of solid are added. Sloppily poured into a big pot, the mouse parts prepare for bubbling as they approach the oven. She lays a table and soon he sat opposite her. Both remain still and curiously look into each other's faces. Neither blink, for their eyes have crusted open, and to tear them free would be unappetizing before a meal. She watches his eyes dart around her face and thinks about how she's never felt them directly in her own. Instead, he always managed to observe her body and would sit staring at her lumps and limbs, deciphering if any would be worthwhile ingesting. In conversation, they would dominate each other through the dance of their bodies, both predatorily rising and relaxing as they observe one another. He rarely recognised her body language being as predatory as his, and never suspected his equal position as prey. Occasionally he would rise from the kitchen table and stare blankly into the oven's heat. This was when she allowed herself to violently dissect his body with her eyes. Recovering from the oven's blast of heat, he fumbled to remove the hair from his face, and she considered his flexed hand. Were those fingers destined for touching her, or for being licked and swallowed whole? The oven timer has ticked enough. It's time to stop waiting for meager mice. Growls echo from her belly, and she moves her faint body onto his lap. Distracted by her fingers caressing his neck, he wraps her into an embrace, and she begins to tighten her legs around his waist. Initially, he takes her clenched movements as an erotic suggestion, until he finds himself panicking in her restrictive hold. Utilizing every elongated limb, he is strangled into position. Each struggle for oxygen allows her grip to tighten, and soon he is sabotaged by his own breath. Stretching her mouth to the point of dislocation, she begins engulfing, and with each convulsion, less of his body remains. A final slurp sucks in the last finger, and she lies on the kitchen floor, lethargic and limp. As the ecstasy of the hunt wears, she begins to regret her feast, and slides under the table to hide. Only a matter of minutes pass under the table, until the oven timer begins to scream. Why couldn't she have waited? It was only a few more minutes. The mice may have satisfied her for a while, and she could have had a few more days with him. Although that would have gambled with his own desire to make prey of her. She regretfully lies, thinking about his body inside hers, and begins looking at how his limbs distort her. Disturbed by the idea of his large intestine knotting with hers, she decides to salvage the muscled rope. Reaching her hand down her throat, she digs uncomfortably until her hand is coiled. Stretching it out of her mouth, she regurgitates it onto the floor next to her, and crawls out from the table to search for a Tupperware. When one is found, she grabs a meaty serpent, who had attempted to slither away, and places it inside. Lowering the lid upon it with a seal, the pet is kept.